Hi guys, welcome to first ever AMA with Pickyourtrail. So the idea behind this whole exercise was for Pickyourtrail to share something with the fellow travelers. I would like to give a brief about what we do and why this entire AMA started. So after having crafted trails for more than 5,000 customers all around the world, and after having spoken and visited these countries, we thought there's a lot of knowledge and a lot of questions that we can share with the users out there, and share our knowledge and make travel a happy thing for a lot of people. And as part of this, what we have also done is we had actually put up this event 3 days before, and we've seen a lot of questions coming our way before the video even started. So we thought that we'll try and keep this format both a section of curated questions from those lists and also taking live questions from the video over here. So before that, I would like to introduce myself. I'm Srinath, co-founder at Pickyourtrail and a part-time travel hacker. This is Sanjay.
Hi guys, I'm Sanjay. So I'm heading operations and supply in Pickyourtrail. So any kind of questions you have with respect to the destinations, I can solve, and I can also help you plan better.
So it sounds great. So in fact, we have our list of questions already streaming in, and a few of them I would probably get started with one of the most important questions that multiple people have asked me specifically. This is particularly coming from Francis, who's mentioned, I've read somewhere that you bought a flight ticket for 200 rupees from India to Kuala Lumpur. Is that true? How did you manage to do that? Well, it's the fun of being a travel hacker, and also given that travel is a passion for me, I've always been on the lookout for great deals. So for all the viewers who have joined us, I would like to just mention, this is our own little secret, which you can definitely try next time for yourself. So there is something called as Air Asia Big App. So what does this app actually mean is, it's their loyalty program app, and every once in a while, once in 3 months, last one happened to be 2 weeks back, they give out free tickets, which is 0 points tickets on their big app, and you have to just keep a lookout for that and sign up for their newsletters when it is coming up, and whenever this preview sale comes up, you can actually look at the list and find out where the 0 point tickets are, and you could get lucky. So like how I got lucky for a ticket from India to Kuala Lumpur, all you have to do is just pay taxes, which is roughly about 100, 200 rupees, and the ticket is yours. And so yep, there's somebody who has given us our first question. What are the best travel blogs that you follow? Hi Vignesh, thanks for that question. Personally, I follow blogs like Two Jindals. I actually follow also Passion Ports, Passing Ports. Arun Narayan heads that blog. And apart from that, I also follow a lot of travel logs, be it Casey Neistat or be it that points guy, because I love travel hacking, so I follow rigorously the points guy and their website. Hi Ranjini, we have another question from you.
So she's asked, when we travel, we try to make the most out of the place, but often end up by not doing so. How do we manage the traveler's guilt?
So that is a very, very tricky question. So actually, you need to define what kind of traveler you are. So there are people who love just leisure, and there are people who want to pack in as much as possible. So first step for you is to define what kind of traveler you are. And a lot also helps when you plan in advance and try and realistically put together an itinerary, in terms of taking into consideration a lot of factors like travel time, logistics, how it goes through. And if planned well at least 2 to 3 months in advance, you will be able to cover maximum places. Read a lot about those places, try and understand what are the logistics behind it, when is a good time to go, and I'm sure you'll be able to pack in as much as possible.
And also have some backup plans where if something you cannot able to manage that trip, you can always have a backup plan where which you can do.
Yeah, and anyways, we are also here at Pickyourtrail to help achieve that target for you. So when people come to us, they generally tell us these are things we want to do, and we try and take into consideration all of the things that I mentioned to you and try building an itinerary for them. So that's how even we approach. So also, I would like to take the second question from our existing list, which says, from Kaushik, what's a good budget to travel in Southeast Asia? So again, a very interesting question, to be very honest. You need to define what is the kind of traveler you are. Are you a luxury traveler? Are you a comfort traveler? Or you are a
backpacker
who is, you know, willing to hustle for any amount of time and anything? Are you willing to hustle? So depending on that, your budget for Southeast Asia can start from as low as 20,000 rupees to it can go as high as 1 lakh. But typically we've seen for destination, depending on the destinations, Bali can be done at even 35-40k to start with. Indonesia, I mean Thailand, can be done at as low as 20,000-25,000 per person. It depends what kind of hostels you want to stay in, all of that put together. It's an interesting question, but there's no one number that fits all answer. Again, we have next question from Zahira. I'm a first time traveler, international traveler. What are the typical do's and don'ts for me? Well, for a first time traveler, there could be a lot of anxiety that could be there, and they might not know a lot of things. Do you have your passport? Is that passport valid for at least 6 months of travel? Does it have your first name, last name correctly? Because airlines make a big deal out of it if your names are not booked. Flight tickets and your passport do not match, then it could become a very big issue during boarding. So that is a basic level check a lot of first time travelers need to do. Beyond that, other basics are the place that you're going to visit. You need to read up a bit and try and understand what is the kind of currency that is involved over there. Should you take a currency card from here, or should you take hard currency from here? So these are all some very basic checks that need to be there. From Shefali we have, would 8 days be a good time to cover Vietnam and Cambodia? And what would be a good budget for these two countries? 8 days for Vietnam, if you want to cover the highlights, definitely possible. Because in Cambodia, the biggest highlight obviously is Siem Reap and Angkor Wat, which is anywhere between 2 to 3 days. And then in Vietnam, the biggest again being Hanoi and Halong Bay, which is about 4 to 5 days. So if I have to answer your question, in 8 days, you can definitely do Vietnam plus Cambodia, at least about two of these cities that I mentioned. And the average good budget would be about 45 to 55,000. I'm assuming you are a leisure and comfort traveler. This would definitely be a good budget to have. Also from Sanjay Krish, we have...
assure me a better price than the one which...
Can you assure me a better price than the one which I can book online myself? So in fact, you can try out... you can try out our website pickyourtrail.com. We have given you all the splits of each line item, be it flights or hotels or activities. We also take pride in the fact that these are best online rates available, and you can definitely try us out to see if there's any difference that you see in terms of pricing when you book online yourself versus booking with us. And now I also see that there are 47 people who are live with us. Welcome again all you guys, and thanks for joining us. It's a great pleasure to have you guys in the video.
It really means a lot also, so
Sanjay, did I answer your question? Yes, okay. Sundar Ganeshan, what percentage of your overall budget is flight expenses? Again, it depends on the destination that you're traveling in Southeast Asia. For a destination which is very close to India, like Thailand, and which has good connectivity like Singapore, Malaysia, it could be anywhere between 30 to 40% of our overall travel budget. You should keep for flight expenses, unless you are able to hack flights like the 200 rupees ticket. Then practically your flight tickets
are... Really, 30 to 40% is a good number.
Yeah, but otherwise, 30 to 40% is an average number that you can go with, definitely. Next question we have is from Vishal. What would one recommend for a backpacker's trip? So again, a good question. If as a backpacker, your motto is to meet people, interact with them, then there are great hubs that you can visit. Hanoi is a great backpackers hub. So is Gili Trawangan, and so is places like Koh Tao, Boracay, and in Thailand there are multiple hubs of backpackers. Like you have
Phangan,
which is known for its great full moon parties as
and
well.
You have Phuket.
Yeah. So, moving on to the next question from Gomati. Which all countries have visa on arrival? Yes, this is a very interesting question. A lot of Indians ask, because visa is almost a nightmare with the list of documents that they ask for. So, for a first time traveler, visa on arrival destinations that we recommend strongly are like Bali,
Cambodia,
Thailand,
Laos,
and Vietnam. All of these are visa on arrival destinations, and pretty simple and hassle free. So you don't have to worry about how do I get my visa, do I have to documentation, etc. So that's something that you don't have to worry about at all when you're visiting these countries. And even in fact, with countries like Singapore and Malaysia, where you have to have visa beforehand, the documentation required is pretty simple and it can be done without you having to visit the embassy or the VFS center or the visa center for submitting your documents. Moving
next
to
the question would be from Nikhil. So given that we are vegetarian, is it safe to travel in terms of food issues?
Southeast Asia,
vegetarians
have it a little difficult, but trust
be
me
a little difficult.
Trust me, you will find a lot of Indian restaurants in a lot of places. So if you are the person who wants to have at least one Indian meal, you will find one Indian restaurant in corner of every place that you're visiting. So that is definitely not a worry. But the idea of traveling is to try out
new things
and
like street
especially
food.
Yeah, especially in Thailand, you have good variety of vegetarian cuisine as well. So like your green curry, red curry, these are very local cuisine, and you should definitely try. Like the sticky rice with mango is a great dish to try out. Beyond that, you have your regulars like pizza, burgers, pasta, which is always available, which every restaurant will serve you, so that's not a problem. Yeah, and in fact, the thing is that I am a vegetarian and I have very big issues with food. I need to have Indian food at least once a day. It sounds very contradictory being a traveler, but unfortunately that's how I am. And I have not had a problem finding food in most of the places I've traveled, and I've at least traveled to about 25 countries. So if you're a vegetarian, you can always find a way out. Not to worry.
And
Ranjini, again, I have another question from you. Can traveler like us, who manage to travel with 9-to-5 jobs, make money from travel blogging? Have you guys tried something like that? Oh, that's a tricky question. Travel blogging is very, very time consuming. Honestly, from the traffic to the website, you making money could be difficult, but if you are able to have a good audience and if you can interest brands to engage with you, and that's definitely a possibility in terms of making money. So you could look at free travel, reviewing properties, or collaborating with flight airlines to review their new products. All these are definitely possible. And
another question from Sanjay Krish. So he's asking, what's the best price you can give me for a Dubai return ticket? So,
okay,
we cannot guarantee a best price, but it depends on when you book also. So I can tell you which is the correct budget for spending a Dubai return ticket would be somewhere between 12 to 16K. So I think that would be the best buy for a Dubai return.
And there's also the myth online that there is a offline pricing for flight tickets. Honestly, nowadays the travel technology for flight has improved so much. So what you see online is probably the best you can get even from an offline travel agent. So you can be rest assured that whatever you see online is the best price at that point of time. But there are always ways for you to wait, sit back and wait for promotions. And I have known people who have got tickets to Dubai for as low as 8-9K also with flights like Air Arabia, where you don't have to land necessarily into
Dubai.
But you can land into Sharjah, and from Sharjah to Dubai it's only about 45 minutes.
45 minutes travel.
So that's advice you can look at. And then we have next from another Vignesh. Hi Vignesh. How's tourism on Cairo, Egypt? I have been interested in this for a long time, but some of my friends say it's an unsafe place to travel right now. Honestly, after the Arab Spring Rising, Egypt has had a decline in tourism. But if you're looking for very active hospitality, it used to be great actually in Cairo. Hospitality used to be awesome and it used to be great, but now because of the decline, it's on the decline. But having said that, it's a great place to go, definitely
we
safe.
We also had 2-3 customers visiting Egypt last month, so
yes,
they've had a nice time.
So if you're worried about safety, as long as you take precautions like not going during the night time, venturing out, all of the basic safety precautions if you take, I'm sure you'll find Cairo or Egypt a great place to visit. So we have other questions as well. From Divyesh Doshi, which country would you recommend for adventure sports? Okay, interesting. So in Southeast Asia, there are variety of things that you can do in Thailand. You can do rock climbing, you can do scuba diving. Like Koh Tao is known world over for scuba diving. It is the one of the places where highest scuba diving certification happens around the world. Koh Tao is there. Then you have in Koh Tao, rock climbing is a very big sport that people try out. Beyond that, snorkeling, rafting, there are a couple of places in Bali, in again in Thailand. So Thailand does offer you a lot of adventure sports that you can definitely try out. Okay. Okay, Vignesh Vaidyanathan, you mentioned my two cents. Your Weho experience was better before the redesign. Oh, this is definitely something I will take back to our product team and let them know, because they felt that our Weho was a MVP product and we needed to make it a lot more consumer friendly. And we are definitely open to listening to your thoughts as well. If you think why it was better, if you can mail us, we'll definitely reach out to you and try and understand it a little bit more in detail. And our email ID, you can reach out to me personally at srinath@pickyourtrail.com with your thoughts. Okay. We have our next question from Vijay Raghavan. What is the safest and most comfortable destination for older couples or parents to travel to? What would be a decent budget?
So, safest destination, I would say Bali. So, Bali is something your parents also would like. It has a lot of things to offer. Like, you have a lot of sightseeing, you have cultural places to visit, and also you have a mix of water activities. Probably if your parents are having that energy to do that water sports, still it has. So, and also it has cruise options. And
more importantly, it being a very tourist friendly place, hospitality is great. And Bali, people in Bali,
make you very comfortable.
Yes.
They make you feel at home. So that is the best place to visit if you
ask me. And they also believe in karma. So they always treat all travelers like, really special. and make sure they feel comfortable. And once you leave from Bali, you'll feel that you've had a great vacation. A decent budget. Surprisingly, Bali is not very expensive if you're traveling from any of the AirAsia hubs and you wait for tickets which are rightly priced. It can start from as low as 70,000 for two people and
go up to 1.4
also. 1.3. Depending on your choices, what kind of hotels you want, but it is definitely possible starting from 70,000 as well. You can try our product as well to see these prices. We have our next question from Preetika. I'm off to Chiang Mai in the next 2 weeks. Wow. I hope you enjoy that. I understand this is a rainy season. Have booked flights of the Gibbon activity. What do you guys think? Would they still operate? Honestly, in Thailand, it is a rainy season, but it is not torrential rains that you would expect, like in Kerala, that it rains 24/7. There are definitely periods during that rain which where you can venture out and. Honestly, depending on the weather on that day,
only
you can definitely visit flights of Gibbon. That's something that is open throughout the year, but if the weather is really bad, that's when they'll stop. Otherwise, you will still have window where you can visit them. We have our next question from Loni. What are the precautions you would suggest for solo female traveler to Southeast Asia? Honestly, Southeast Asia is definitely a very safe place to visit as long as you take basic precaution. We have had people going for bachelor party with us, older women like 60 plus traveling with us. We have had people, middle-aged traveling with us. So it is definitely not a problem as long as you are self-confident. That is very, very important.
You have to be very open. You have to mingle with strangers. You have to be very comfortable with that kind of travel as well.
Yeah, so with respect to if you're confident and especially if you have traveled before or even if it's your first time travel, if you are confident, you know the place a bit and you are open to meeting people and making friends, I'm sure you will enjoy your first solo travel in Southeast Asia.
So we also have our next
question from Prabha Sridharan. Which place would you suggest for a family traveling with toddlers less than 2 years? Okay. At the risk of repeating.
Child-friendly, again, I would say Singapore, Bali, Hong Kong is also one option.
Hong Kong is, again, a great place. If your kids are able to walk and they understand something, you can take them to the amusement parks over there. Disneyland, Southeast Asia, the nearest, apart from Shanghai, is available in Hong Kong. So I'm sure they will enjoy that place. And beyond that, Bali continues to be
family-friendly.
Yeah, it's a very family-friendly place. Like, especially the queries that we get for toddlers with less than 2 years is, can I have a kitchen where I can make food for the baby? Can we have places where you have to step out for 1 or 2 hours? Bali offers a lot of that for families traveling with kids. So in fact, you can check out our Facebook reviews where people have traveled with infants also and how they have enjoyed it. So you can definitely try Bali and Singapore or Hong Kong. Best place for water sports with kids under 3 years. All right. And budget for 4 people. It gets a little tricky with respect to water sports with kids under 3 years unless you're open to taking turns and doing the water sports activities. It could become difficult because a lot of sports do not allow infants or children less than age of 4 or 7 years.
Budget for 4 people, I would say somewhere between 1.3 to 1.8.
Yeah, that could be
a decent number
to look at. We have our next question from Arun Ramachandran. What is your advice for vegetarian travelers to Southeast Asia? Should I stock up on Maggi? You don't have to. Definitely, you will find Indian restaurants in Southeast Asia. We just answered that question a moment back. I think we have our next viewer, Ashwin Rao, who is a stand-up comedian. Welcome, Thanks for joining us on AMA. Happy to have you here. Planning to do a Vietnam, Laos, Cambodia, December end to New Year's. Will 10 days suffice? Are they all safe now? Is Laos worth it or just Vietnam and Cambodia? Oh boy, I am actually doing Vietnam, Laos, Cambodia, and I am doing it by bike, but I am doing it for about 16 days and I feel that is not enough. So
I think it depends on what kind of interest you have, what places you want to cover.
So mostly it will be, if you're doing it in 10 days, you'll be covering one or two places in each of these countries, not more than that. And Laos is definitely amazing place to go. So if you go in north, Luang Prabang, culturally very strong, you can get to meet a lot of people over there. It has a great backpacking culture and you can visit the waterfalls and the lakes over there. If you go south of Vientiane, there are caves that you can explore in Laos, and obviously you have the Thousand Islands also that you can visit. It's definitely safe now, a lot better than what it used to be. And if I were you, during the New Year's time, I would try, if 10 days is a strict criteria that you have, I would try and limit it to two countries, predominantly Vietnam and Cambodia, because logistics is easier for you, a lot more flights are there, and you will enjoy your 10 days without the feeling that you have to travel every other day and you're just spending most of your time in travel. So we have our next question from Akif Husseini. Enough adventure coming up in your life in the next 4 months. I think this is intended for Sanjay. He's getting engaged very soon. So I don't know if it is particularly directed towards him. We have our next question from Srivatsan. Planning for a solo trip in the month of October. Looking for a minimum 30 days vacation. Wow. Looking to cover minimum 5 to 7 countries. How do I plan the itinerary?
This is everybody's dream, but nobody actually executes that itinerary.
I'm going to personally congratulate you that you've got 30 days. If you're working, that's a big, big thing. And if you're a student and you finished your college, it's a great time to actually be on the road traveling. 30-day vacation, I would try and keep it to mostly connected countries, which would be Thailand, Laos, Vietnam, Cambodia. If you are looking to do this belt, you will find a lot of backpackers, you will find a lot of people, you will enjoy it. And how do you plan the itinerary? Oh boy, interesting. You can definitely give a shot to our Pickyourtrail website. It will help you in terms of planning for even 30 days and it has all the countries that we just mentioned. So all the best for your trip. Next question we have from Kapil, a very interesting question. Can we combine
Universal and Sentosa on the same day? Okay, so I would definitely not recommend that, because Universal people have given us enough feedback saying even one day is not enough to cover Universal Studios. So I would not advise you to club both these activities on one day, because you'll have a lot of rides in Universal which you have to cover, and then also Sentosa, it has at least 20 rides. So I would advise you to take it separately.
And if you have any kind of motion sickness, Universal Studios buffer in some time for just taking it easy as well, because there are a lot of adrenaline rides that are there in Universal Studio, which you should take a proper rest and then do. Ashwin has asked us, also without air tickets, how much would it cost per head? We intend to Airbnb in both countries. Agenda is sightseeing. Interesting question. Airbnb or hotels, honestly, in these places, they don't make much of a difference unless you're a very big group and you're looking for a 4-bedroom, 5-bedroom. If you're only two, you might get similar deals in hotels as well. But keeping both Airbnb and hotels in mind, because you're traveling in December, I would say it'll be 20% more, and our general budget is about 40 to 50,000 without the flight tickets. This includes your travel, this includes your food, this includes your stay and activities. Add 20% to it, because it's December, honestly, and December typically is the toughest time to travel, because whatever you pay just a month before, you will be paying 20% more. Our next question we have from
Lakshman.
Info on visa on arrival. I don't know what.
So probably the documents he's asking about. I think so. What documents you need to carry is it depends. So bank statement. It varies from country to country. So it might vary from 3 months to 6 months, and then a valid photograph. Apart from that, you need to carry a valid travel document, which is flight ticket and your hotel stay. That'd be it.
Right. And we have our next question from Rahul Bholu. Hi, Rahul. Planning for China and Hong Kong, 1 week itinerary in October, November this year. Please suggest. Okay, interesting. You could try and combine either Shanghai plus Hong Kong, or you could do Hong Kong plus Macau itself for a week, because it has a lot to offer in both these places, and do a day trip to Shenzhen if you are interested in good quality shopping. And getting these rip-off brands. Shenzhen is the place to go, so you can definitely try and do that. Beyond that, October, November is also a good time to go, so that is definitely there. So we have our next question from Sanjay.
She specifically asked me, so I had come across many people who have the perception that Thailand is not a good destination for family vacation. What's your comment on this? Okay, so what I would advise is for family, it again depends. So if you're planning to travel to places like Phuket, Chiang Mai, there's to be honest, Thailand is a very safe place to travel. You don't have to worry about whether you're going with family or not. And coming to which part of the country you're going to cover. So if it's going to be Phuket, you'll find a lot of youngsters crowd who are typically in for an adventure activity and also for the party. So it depends whether you're comfortable moving around with that crowd. It all depends on how you're looking to plan.
Alright, and also we wanted to just make a small announcement. The best question on this ask me anything is gonna get you a 2000 rupees Taj voucher. So shoot away with your questions and make it as
exciting as possible,
for us to answer and for us to shortlist. Okay, we have our next question from Satya Pradeep. Hi Satya. We are an adventure seeking couple. Wow. That's a rare combination. Looking to travel every year around the New Year's time. Oh, that's a good time to have your birthday. Everybody's celebrating. When is the best time to start planning the trip, and how can Pickyourtrail help us? Honestly, if you're looking for December, we encourage everybody to plan at least four to five months in advance. Because there are two reasons to it. One, you get these 60-day, 90-day, 120-day promotions that happen in flights, in hotels. Availability is there, and the pricing are not very high. So if you're looking for December, any time between July, August, you should definitely plan. You will save at least 15-20%. And reach out to us. You can drop us an email at planners@pickyourtrail.com if you have no idea where you want to travel, or if you have basic idea, you can definitely try out our product pickyourtrail.com, where almost all the Southeast Asian countries are there, or which you can dabble with, get an idea what is the average budget like, and build on your itinerary over there. And you definitely will also have our back in terms of our destination experts who can help you craft the perfect birthday vacation that you are looking for.
So we have an exciting question now. So can we expect India itineraries from PYT soon for travel within our country?
Oh, we've been struggling with this question for some time, and we want to, but we will have to wait as well, because honestly, a lot of technology challenges in terms of getting supply on board online is a huge challenge still in India. But we have slowly started taking baby steps in terms of starting to do Andaman. So that's something that we have started doing, and we hope very soon we'll be able to cater to a lot more other destinations. So thanks for your question again.
And we have a question coming from Krishnamurti. Sanjay, where are in Southeast Asia can we take Uber? It'll be economical than the local taxis. Okay, so Uber is operating in all the countries in Southeast Asia predominantly, like except for Cambodia and Laos. So Uber, I would definitely recommend. In fact, in places like Singapore, Uber Pool also is very, very effective and economical. You not only get to meet new people, you can, you know, strike up a conversation with them and try and understand about the place a little bit more. And you can always be on the lookout for these Uber coupons that they keep giving every week that can bring down your travel. Like in Singapore, when I was there, I traveled from the center of the city to Sentosa. It took me about $13. That's about it. And which is very, very economical. And it also is, because Uber is on demand, you can decide when you're traveling. So yes, definitely Uber is something you can look at. So not just Uber, but any of these taxi hailing aggregators. So we have next question from Sriram. He's also been our customer with us, and he's been a very good friend of ours. So he's asking, hi Sri, Jet Aero is offering an all-inclusive 4 nights, 5 days to Dubai at 29k. Is this real? I thought you are the best travel hackers I'm aware of and could guide me as well. So, very interesting offer and very interesting question. So Sriram, let me quickly check on this and try and understand what exactly the deal is about, and I can give you my best opinion on it, and you know, I can probably take this offline as well.
It might be a flight plus hotel only deal. So we'll have a look and we'll definitely get back to you on this.
But I can keep you assured again that, you know, we'll be able to offer you great experience and great pricing. Next we have question is from Shikha Balakrishnan. Could you point me to where I can look for an off the beaten trail itinerary in Cambodia? Okay, that is interesting. So off the beaten trail in Cambodia, there are beyond Siem Reap and beyond Siem Reap, if you're looking to explore to the countryside of Cambodia, you need to have a large heart as well, because the roads are really bad and safety could be an issue. Especially I've you know, even heard from a good friend of mine and the guy who's explored Cambodia much in detail, Rohit Subramaniam. He's had you know, very exciting and adventurous experiences in Cambodia, which at the hindsight now you can laugh and have a good memories of it, but at that time it could be a little you know, nerve-wracking as well. So there are definitely some interesting things you can do in Cambodia if you step outside of Siem Reap, but I would try and take this offline to try and understand a little bit more. You can again reach out to me at srinath@pickyourtrail.com, and we can probably definitely discuss this offline. So we have our next question from Ashwin Ramaswamy. Hi Ashwin, how are you doing? What's the best undiscovered water hill location in Southeast Asia that's kid friendly, and how to hack travel to such a location? Kid friendly with a family, I've never tried travel hacking, honestly. So even Hari, who's the other co-founder at Pickyourtrail, has made it a point that he will do as much as travel as possible before the kids become more than 2 years, because infants practically travel free. So that's one travel hack I would definitely advise. If your kids are less than 2 years, try and pack in as much travel as possible, because after 2, they are also charged tickets. So that's one advice. Beyond that, undiscovered water hill locations in Southeast Asia, you can definitely try Bohol. AirAsia has good connectivity to Philippines. Bohol is a very nice hill location. You have the chocolate mountains over there that you can try. And then you have Cebu, you have Honda Bay in Philippines, which has amazing water beaches and underwater life that you can try out. But again, with kids, you can at best probably do snorkeling or take turns to, you know, do this one by one. And then next question is from Kashmira. I'm in Hong Kong for a week next month. Any must-dos?
Okay, Kashmira, I've known Kashmira personally as well. So she is, somebody had asked us previously how safe is it for a solo female traveler. So here's an example. She's been doing a lot of solo travel for a long time, including Europe and Southeast Asia. Any must-dos? Well, you should definitely try and visit the night markets in Hong Kong if you're a foodie. And beyond that, I don't know, Hong Kong is very, very commercialized, so I don't know if I can answer very particularly your question in terms of any must-dos.
Okay, so we have another question from Ranjini. Can we choose a multi-country travel with BYT, say covering Singapore and Malaysia? Do you offer flexible transportation or do you just stick with flights to hop on from one place to another?
So we are working on multimodal transportation between cities as well. But honestly, if you are struggling or you want options, you can always reach out to our destination planners. They'll be more than happy to, you know, give you a lot more recommendations, which is currently not there in product, but it will be very soon be available on product, and we have that planned for our next quarter as a feature. So look out for it when it comes. And the next question is from Mrs. Bhuneshwari Sanjeev. She's also traveled with us. So
to use US and New Zealand. Hi Sanjay, had an amazing. Thanks for the lovely guest, ma'am. I appreciate it.
And then we have our offline question as well. Next one, very interesting, is from Deepthi. Considering Southeast Asia in general, how vibrant is the nightlife? Okay, on a scale of sober to extremely wild, where you'll not even remember what you did the last time, it can get that crazy. So you have really great places where nightlife is almost crazy, and you will not find anywhere else such places. So like Phangan, full moon party is one best example. So we were there during December last year, and I got to know from a friend over there who we met in a hostel. He said that the party starts at 9 o'clock in the night, ends at 6 o'clock, and the after party starts at 7 o'clock in the morning and ends at 3 p.m. So that's how crazy that place is. Alright, we have our next question from Keshav Rao. Hi Keshav, I'm planning for a trip to Singapore, Malaysia within this year. Can you suggest me a best ideal time to visit? I don't want to go to these places when it is too crowded. Kindly suggest. Okay, if you're looking to visit both these places, I would definitely not recommend going during December, because the entire world is traveling at that point of time and it is best avoided. Anytime between September, October just before the Puja holidays as well, is a good time to visit these places, and it doesn't take a lot of time in terms of visas also. You can definitely plan in September, October sometime, where weather will also be a little pleasant, not very harsh, and you can take it, definitely travel during that time.
So the next question is from Sabin Rodriguez. Would you recommend doing a drive across Thailand? Yes, I would definitely recommend. Again, it depends on the kind of itinerary you're going to choose. But if you're going to be a bike lover, then yes, that would be the best place to go on for a drive.
And only one thing is, it is tricky. Definitely carry international driving permit, because it is not mandatorily asked everywhere, but if you get caught somewhere, they might ask for it, and you don't want to be paying unnecessary fine over there. Getting IDP is about 1 or 2 days job, and it costs you practically nothing, 1,500 rupees, and it's a very straightforward process. I would strongly recommend take an IDP and drive across Thailand like crazy. We have our next offline question as well, from Akram. Will Indian rupees be accepted there for exchange?
Yes.
So you want to take that question?
Yeah. So they do accept, but you'll have very limited foreign currency shops which accepts Indian money. But we definitely recommend you to exchange it to USD or the local currency from here itself, so that you get the best price. So if you're going to, if you want to change it over there, the price, the currency exchange price would be very less. for India INR. So
yeah, and also the fact that you know, there are very few places which will take Indian currency over there. I would strongly recommend taking a travel card from here or exchanging to the local currency and taking it from there. We also have our next offline question from Manu, sorry, from Ashwin. Hotels or hostels? Okay, it's a very, very interesting question. So honestly, I've been a mix of both. People will laugh at me if I say mix of both, because most of the time I've driven even a group of 12 people with children to stay in hostels. So I have always loved hostels, because purely because of the fact that you get to meet a lot of people. It is exciting. The vibes are you know, very, very high over there, and you'll enjoy the experience. You get to feel the place. But beyond that, there are certain places. Honeymoon, hostels, definitely a no. So hotels, where if it's a special occasion that you're going for and you would want some privacy, definitely hotels. For some people, there's a hybrid option as well, which is private rooms in a hostel where you get the best of both worlds. So
mix of both.
The answer suits your requirements, honestly speaking. So next question we have, this is something a lot of people ask us, which is forex cards or currencies. What is the ideal combination for countries like Thailand and Cambodia? Honestly, it depends on the guy you're buying currency from. So we have our own trusted partners which we recommend to our travelers. So if you take currencies, more often than not, it works out cheaper if you're able to find the right partner. Otherwise, forex cards are also very convenient because you don't have to carry cash, but in places like in the airport, when you have to pay for your visa, you don't have to, you know, struggle and get money. So it's definitely a good combination to carry currency. And instead of forex card, I would recommend taking your credit card itself. Take as much currency and then swipe credit card wherever you're looking to, you know, use for a high ticket purchase. So instead of forex card, I would definitely recommend credit cards as well. Next question we have from Varun Lakshman. Between Singapore and Hong Kong, which is the most affordable city to stay? Singapore, hands down.
Hong Kong
is way too expensive.
Yes. And also you get a very smaller room size in Hong Kong.
We've been told that we missed in between few questions. So I will just take again from, what are the visa docs? Again from Krishnamurti, what are the visa docs requirement for Southeast SEA countries? It depends on the country that you're visiting. Most of the countries are visa on arrival. Certain countries where you are traveling, like Singapore and Malaysia, basic stuff like your travel itinerary, which is your flights and hotels.
And then your bank statement for
bank
the last 3 months or last 6 months. Depending
supporting
on
your financial means to travel to these
and
countries.
And then passport size photo.
Yeah. And then next question we have from, I think it's addressed to Sanjay.
Plan a trip with our Chennai 61 guys soon, I wish. To travel with our guys. Yes,
yeah,
definitely. That's, we can do that before our marriage.
Our
for
marriage?
marriage.
Okay. Again from Ashwin Rao, we have a question, which is, are car rentals a viable option in and around Vietnam and Cambodia? Are we better off with local transport? I would go a step ahead. If you are a person who can drive two-wheelers, I would recommend two-wheelers because it's faster, you can beat the traffic, and it's easy. It's like the local Activas you have here, scooties you have here. It's quite easy to rent, very cheap, and you can definitely have a good fun driving them in the city as well. Beyond that, car rental is also a possibility, but you'll have to struggle with the parking, with respect to getting IDP, getting used to the road and the traffic could be a problem. But beyond that, if you are a motorhead, go ahead, nobody's stopping you.
So next question is from Aishwarya Ashok. I'm planning to go to Singapore, Malaysia, but I don't have a job and I just finished college. Will visa be an issue for me? Frankly speaking, to Southeast Asia country, I don't think you'll have a problem unless and until you have a strong support from your parents and also
yeah,
an NOC letter.
So as long as your father is or father or brother or anybody is sponsoring, I don't think it'll be a problem. And if you're looking to travel solo, you can first try and explore Malaysia, because it has online e-visa option as well, which is quite easy to get.
So the next question is from Krishnamurthy again. Have you stayed at Hong Kong Capsule Hotel? Is it a safe experience?
No,
yeah. I think we haven't stayed.
I have stayed in Bangkok, so I can say it is a very unique experience, definitely. And with respect to safety, it depends on where you're staying. So if it's a shady place that you're looking to hire a capsule hotel, it could be difficult. But there are very big brands as well which offer this very unique experience. If you go there, I'm sure you'll enjoy it.
So Siddharth Shankar is asking, is it easy to travel within Vietnam or Thailand? Buses, trains, taxis, etc. So yeah, definitely commute between the city or within the cities is easy. Between Thailand or Vietnam, I would suggest Thailand is a better option, and it has good commute facilities as well.
Yeah, and in fact now Southeast Asia has improved a lot in terms of infrastructure. So in fact you have buses which go between Thailand and Cambodia, Thailand and Laos, Vietnam and Cambodia. So there is definitely a lot of infrastructure improvement, both in terms of highways, the quality of buses that you have. So you be rest assured, public transport, a lot of places you will find interesting options. You also have our next offline question. How reliable is street shopping? Can bargaining help? Has bargaining ever not helped anybody? I doubt so. Because I'm a little bad at bargaining, but I've had my friends. When a normal price starts at 1000 baht, they will start at 50 and end up buying at 75. It's so surprising. So never give up on bargaining, especially street side. If you try doing it in high street shopping, you'll be look very different. I mean, people will judge you, but in street shopping, please feel free and bargain as much as you can. And we have last 5 minutes, so we'll pick up as many questions as possible, definitely. So we have our next question from Parvez. Can a special dinner be arranged at hotel for special occasions? By all means, this is definitely a possibility, but a lot of hotels sometimes do not respond on time to your request, and last minute when you reach hotel and ask them, they might not have the facilities, but it is definitely a possibility. How we try and tackle the situation is that we have built relationship with hotels, especially to the places that we send customers frequently, like Bali or even Mauritius or Maldives, wherein we put in a request to them well in advance, basis your requirements, what kind of romantic dinner that you're looking for, it can definitely be done. But you can also try your luck by writing directly to the hotels, and a few good hotels do respond back as well. But try and make sure that you do it in advance rather than going to the hotel and trying to arrange for a special dinner, because the last minute it can get a little difficult.
So we have another question from Santana Santi Kumar. Which have Southeast countries have visa on arrival for Indians? So there are three countries. One is Cambodia, one is Laos, and one is Thailand. So
and Indonesia is also there.
Bali.
So there are definitely very friendly in Southeast Asia visa on arrival. Even if you take closer to home, Sri Lanka is there, Maldives is there, that you can go without visa in advance. You just go there, land there and get visa. That is also a possibility. We also would like to take one offline question here. How does one go to Laos? Is it safe to go there? I think this was asked again by one of our viewers over here. So going to Laos is probably one thing that I'll address. Which is the fact that from Bangkok you have flights, from Kuala Lumpur you have flights, from Thailand you can travel by road. There are definitely a lot of us from Vietnam by road, definitely you can cross borders and reach Laos. There are now multiple modes of transportation that you can reach to Laos, and it has become a lot more accessible right now. So definitely give it a shot and you should try. And I think I will take the last question because
for the day.
Yeah. Last question is from Keshav Rao. I have another question. I heard that in Bali you need to follow some dress code during temple visits.
Yes.
Is that true?
That is true, Keshav Rao. So you need to. They have a specific dress code which you need to follow. So
it's like any other place. You need to, you know, respect certain traditions and customs. With that in mind, these are very, you know, you can even go and rent there, so you don't have to struggle finding how do I carry that dress from here. You can always get that, very easy access is there. But these dress and you need to wear is purely to respect their customs and their traditions. So we would definitely recommend and respect, you respect their tradition as well.
It's like so,
yeah, it's like how you visit the Ayyappan temple in Kerala, you will have to respect their tradition. It's very similar to that. So I think with this, we are coming to the end of our first ever Ask Me Anything with Pick Your Trail. And it was really, really exciting. Thanks a lot. We've had, so many viewers asking us so many questions. And it was really, really interesting. So we would love to hear your feedback. You can write again to us at planners@pickyourtrail.com for getting feedback, or you can write to us at mktg@pickyourtrail.com to give your valuable feedback to us. And you can reach out to us on Facebook at facebook.com/pickyourtrail. You can reach out to us at Twitter and Instagram for your daily dose of travel inspiration. And we hope that we are able to take this forward and have a lot more sessions for different destinations. It would be great if you can drop us comments in the comment section in terms of what would you like to hear in the next AMA session. We would like definitely try and put that come up with an interesting video next time. Thanks a lot. Have a nice weekend.
Thanks a lot, guys. So, yeah, thanks a lot.